this evening. First, we'll discuss the changes in the shadow cabinet for the opposition. Jermaine Figueroa has been removed from his shadow cabinet role, reducing his speaking time in the National Assembly. Nima Flubes is now the new shadow cultural, youth and sports minister. We'll also look at other portfolio changes within the opposition and the reactions, including Figueroa's displeasure over the lack of communication regarding his removal. Turning to cultural affairs, preparations for Mashramani 2024 are in full swing. The Ministry of Culture, Youth and Sports aims to make this a grand event with vibrant costume bands and a diverse musical lineup, including adding dance hall to the Soka Monarch competition. We'll discuss the expansion of Mashramani festivities to various regions and the ministry's efforts to engage citizens in the celebration. The Georgetown Lighthouse has been formally recognized as a national monument. We'll cover the presentation of a wooden heritage marker by the National Trust of Guyana and what this recognition means for the historical landmark. Regarding the upcoming budget 2024, the opposition has raised concerns about the government's focus and priorities. We'll explore the critiques regarding the budget's potential impact on citizens' well-being and opposition's call for more people-centered measures and their plans to present an alternative vision during the budget debate. Finally, we report on the situation in Ecuador, where soldiers are patrolling cities amid a declared war between the government and drug gangs. We'll look into the impact of this conflict on public safety and residents' lives. Welcome to this broadcast of Channel 2's Headline News Update for January 11, 2024. I am Bibi Backus. Thank you for joining us. First up, Opposition Member of Parliament Jermaine Figueroa has been removed from the shadow cabinet by opposition leader Aubrey Norton, specifically from the Cultural, Youth and Sports portfolio. This change reduces Figueroa's speaking time in the National Assembly from 35 minutes to 15 minutes. Nima Flubes has been appointed as the new shadow cultural, youth and sports minister. Other portfolio changes sees Natasha Singh Lewis taking over education from Coretta MacDonald, now in charge of labor. The oil and gas sector, primarily handled by David Patterson of the Alliance for Change, has been assigned to the PNCR's chairman, Shireen Holder. Patterson is now responsible for public works. Attorney-at-law Geeta Chandan Edmund is now responsible for governance, and attorney-at-law Kemrat Ramjetan takes over the home affairs portfolio from her. Figueroa noted that he acknowledges Norton's right to make changes, but expresses displeasure over the lack of prior communication, deeming it disrespectful. Figueroa vows to focus on his role as chairman of the Parliamentary Public Accounts Committee and assure support for Flubes. Politicians have suggested that Norton's decision may have stemmed from personal issues, including Figueroa's interaction with members of the PPPC. Figueroa questions whether the decision results from his independent thinking and handshaking with the president. In a letter to the PNCR Central Executive Committee, Figueroa defends his contribution and appeals for a review of the decision. Also making the headlines, the upcoming budget 2024 is being criticized by the opposition as unlikely to bring real gains for the people, with concerns raised about the government's focus on infrastructure over citizens' well-being. The opposition anticipates continuing ad hoc projects rather than a comprehensive national development plan, emphasizing quality of expenditure over quality of life. The critique asserts that the budget is expected to benefit the PPP elite, family and friends, rather than the middle and lower classes. The opposition calls for measures such as cost of living allowances, raising the income tax threshold, reducing VAT, removing VAT from locally manufactured food items, rationalizing utility rates, increasing the minimum wage, removing personal income tax for low-wage earners, providing risk allowance for frontline workers, and guaranteeing households a minimum livable income. The opposition plans to present an alternative vision during the budget debate, emphasizing a people-centered approach that prioritizes citizens' well-being and shared prosperity. On a different note, preparations for Mashramani 2024, a vibrant celebration of Guyanese culture, are underway, and the Ministry of Culture, Youth and Sports aim to make it the most significant event to date. Director of National Events Andrew Tindall revealed plans for more vibrant costume bands, an energetic parade, and high-quality performances by local artists. The ministry is actively engaged in the private sector to encourage participation in the costume and float parade, focusing on having more costume bands. This year, Master Mani festivities will extend to regions 3, 6, 9, and 10 to foster greater citizen involvement. In a move to reflect musical diversity, dancehall has been added as a new category in the annual Soca Monarch competition. The inclusion of dancehall aligns with the ministry's commitment to promoting the development of young talents and enriching the festival, a unique and important Guyanese product. Guyanese are encouraged to partake in the Mashramani costume and float parade, embracing the spirit of celebration on Republic Day. Stick around when we return. Ghana Fire Service launches intensive community engagement amidst surge in fires, and Georgetown Lighthouse was officially designated as a national monument.
Not a single bar of service.
Not with us. Digicel officially has the best mobile coverage in Guyana. Ookla, the company behind Speedtest, recognizes Digicel as the network with the best mobile coverage in Guyana. Be it in Aishalton or in Etiringbang, we got you covered.
Digicel, the award-winning network for everyone, everywhere.
Good girl, forget things.
What's the problem, Granny?
I want money for bar for doing surgery. I was dancing and I fall and fracture my hip.
If you need some quick money, you should check Lenders Jewelry and Pawn Shop.
Lenders Jewelry and Pawn Shop, lot 238 South Road, border Georgetown. Get jewelry made to order in just 72 hours. We also accept vehicles. Lenders, best rates, longest payback period.
Boys, I get through. Plus, I could dance again.
Lenders Jewelry and Pawn Shop.
Optical services. Let our professional team examine and prescribe what's best for your eyes. Hard smiles make fashionable faces. See us for a full line of optical services, including brand name and prescription eyewear. Modern Optical Services. 316 Mill Street, Georgetown. Telephone 226-1082.
When you need money, and you gotta get it fast, Creative Jewelry and Pawn Shop is the place for that confidential transaction in a quiet and secure location. You'll get the highest value per penny weight for your gold, and also enjoy the lowest interest rates and longest payback period too. Yes, for that instant transaction to solve a pressing financial problem. Let Creative Jewelry and Pawn Shop, 4-6 Boyle Place, that's between the Ministry of Housing on Brick Dam and White Castle Fish Shop, be your first and only choice. Creative Jewelry and Pawn Shop, safe and sound, solid and secure, always there for you. Telephone 231-7878 and 223-8955.
Furnishing your home or office has never been easier. Here at Kisun's, our inventory of locally made and imported furniture, offered at amazing prices, will leave you wanting more. From vinyl, floor rugs and carpets, bedroom, dining and living room sets, mattresses, pillows, office desk, chairs and filing cabinets, outdoor benches and tables, we have a piece of furniture for every room imaginable in your home or office. Check out our flagship store at Industrial Site Rijnveld or one of our branches in New Amsterdam, Port Morant, Caverton, and Camp Street. Kisun's Furniture, furnishing homes for over 50 years.
GCOM is currently conducting a claims and objections exercise to produce an official list of electors, OLE. If you will be 18 years or over by December 31, 2023, and you are a Guyanese citizen by birth, descent, or naturalization, or a citizen from a Commonwealth country living in Guyana for 1 year or more, you are eligible for inclusion in the OLE. GCOM has posted the preliminary list of electors, PLE, for all registration divisions at popular locations across Guyana for you to check if you are listed and, if so, whether your particulars are accurate. You can make a claim for registration if you are not listed, change correction to your particulars if they are incorrect, or object to the inclusion of anyone who you believe should not be on the list. If you are desirous of making a claim or objection, you must visit the GCOM registration office responsible for your area of residence to do so. The claims aspect of this exercise will end on Monday, the 15th of January, 2024. The objections aspect of this exercise will end on Monday, the 22nd of January, 2024. All GCOM registration offices will be open Mondays to Fridays from 8 hours to 18 hours, Saturdays and Sundays from 10 hours to 14 hours. For further information, contact GCOM at 225-027-829 or visit our website at www.gcom.org.gy.
Welcome back. The Guyana Fire Service has responded to more than 25 fires since the year began. These fires have originated from electrical issues, arson, and in some cases, negligence. This alarming number has prompted the fire service to initiate community engagements nationwide. Citizens can expect to learn about fire safety and prevention through firefighters tasked with raising awareness one person at a time. The fire service is dedicated to continually enhancing community engagement while striving to raise awareness and prevent future fires. Through outreach events, public education, and collaboration with local organizations, the fire service aims to educate residents on fire safety measures, evacuation procedures, and early detection. By fostering a shared responsibility, the fire service hopes to build a resilient country where everyone actively participates in fire prevention efforts, promoting a safer environment for all. In other news, the Georgetown Lighthouse has received formal recognition as a national monument with the presentation of a wooden heritage marker by the National Trust of Guyana. The plaque was presented to Louise Williams, Director of Ports and Harbor at the Maritime Administration Department, by Himandri Ramatar of the National Trust of Guyana, Ministry of Culture, Youth and Sports. The 1830 lighthouse is now marked as a designated national monument and a vital heritage resource in Guyana. Although this building no longer functions as the guiding beacon for vessels entering and exiting the Demerara Channel, it remains a historical marker for the nation. Mrs. Williams expressed her gratitude on behalf of MARID for the recognition bestowed by the National Trust of Guyana. Don't go away after the break. Poland police arrest ex-lawmakers amid rising tension between new and old governments. And ICJ concludes first day of hearing in genocide case against Israel.
I was dancing and I fall and fracture my hip.
If you need some quick money, you should check Lenders Jewelry and Pawn Shop.
Lenders Jewelry and Pawn Shop, lot 238 South Road, border Georgetown. Get jewelry made to order in just 72 hours. We also accept vehicles. Lenders, best rates, longest payback period.
Boys, I get through. Plus, I could dance again.
Lenders Jewelry and Pawn Shop.
Furnishing your home or office has never been easier. Here at Kisun's, our inventory of locally made and imported furniture, offered at amazing prices, will leave you wanting more. From vinyl, floor rugs, and carpets, bedroom, dining, and living room sets, mattresses, pillows, office desk, chairs, and filing cabinets, outdoor benches and tables, we have a piece of furniture for every room imaginable in your home or office. Check out our flagship store at Industrial Site Rijnveld or one of our branches in New Amsterdam, Port Morant, Caverton, and Camp Street. Kisun's Furniture, furnishing homes for over 50 years.
Services. Let our professional team examine and prescribe what's best for your eyes. Current smalls make fashionable faces. volunteers for full line of optical services, including brand name and prescription eyewear. Modern Optical Services, 316 Middle Street, Georgetown, telephone 226-1082.
When you need money and you've got to get it fast, Creative Jewelry and Pawn Shop is the place for that confidential transaction in a quiet and secure location. You'll get the highest value per penny weight for your gold and also enjoy the lowest interest rates and longest payback period too. Yes, for that instant transaction to solve a pressing financial problem. Let Creative Jewelry and Pawn Shop, 4-6 Boyle Place, that's between the Ministry of Housing on Brick Dam and White Castle Fish Shop, be your first and only choice. Creative Jewelry and Pawn Shop, safe and sound, solid and secure, always there for you. Telephone 231-7878 and 223-8955.
Experience more than award-winning speed.
Way more.
Get the best that LTE has to offer on Digicel, officially the fastest mobile network in Guyana. Ookla, the company behind Speedtest, recognizes Digicel as the best mobile network in Guyana. With the best LTE experience and the fastest data speeds, experience it all with Digicel, the award-winning network for everyone, everywhere.
GCOM is currently conducting a claims and objections exercise to produce an official list of electors OLE. If you will be 18 years or over by December 31st, 2023, and you are a Guyanese citizen by birth, descent, or naturalization, or a citizen from a Commonwealth country living in Guyana for 1 year or more, you are eligible for inclusion in the OLE. GCOM has posted the preliminary list of electors, PLE, in all of the registration divisions across Guyana for you to check if you are listed, and if so, whether your particulars are accurate. If you have changed your address since you were registered, you are required to visit the GCOM registration office responsible for your new area of residence to apply for a transfer. Monday, 15 January 2024 is the last day on which you can apply for a transfer. For further information, contact GCOM at 225-0278-9 or visit our website at www.gcom.org.gy.
Welcome back. Now we take a look at what's happening in the region and around the world. Hundreds of soldiers in Ecuador are on patrol in several cities after the government and drug gangs declared war. Many streets are nearly deserted as residents fear being attacked. Al Jazeera's Alessandro Rampietti reports.
A day after gang members looted stores and terrified people in Quito's historic center, the streets usually brimming with locals and tourists were desolate. Most stores were closed, as were schools and public offices. The area close to the presidential palace cordoned off with soldiers on patrol. Alex Lozada, who kept his stall closed, says he showed up to protect his belongings.
Yesterday was terrifying. People running desperately up and down. And around 3 in the afternoon we had to close. It's very dangerous. We are all afraid we'll be robbed or worse.
A sentiment of anguish and worry that others who ventured out shared.
We can't go to work in this situation. Children can't go to school. Our country is in pieces. We need the president to solve this because it's gone berserk.
The president, Daniel Noboa, who declared the state of emergency on Monday and ordered that criminal gangs be neutralized on Tuesday, met with diplomats and international organizations, saying the violence was a reaction to his plans of building new high-security prisons. He promised not to back down and announced he would begin to deport 1,500 foreign prisoners, mostly Colombians, to cut the number of inmates.
We're living in a state of war against terrorism. These aren't organized crime groups, they're terrorists, some of whom finance themselves with drug trafficking and some others with people smuggling in organs as well as weapons.
Most Ecuadorians are still trying to make sense of what has been an unprecedented day of simultaneous violence in many cities. Tension remains palpable. Streets are empty even at rush hour as Quito and Ecuador prepare for another night of curfew.
And the crisis is far from over. 139 prison guards and employees are still being held hostage by inmates in 5 jails. And there were still incidents and clashes in various parts of the country as the armed forces operation continues. This wave of violence was triggered by the disappearance of a convicted criminal the government hoped to transfer, but it's only the latest in a country increasingly in the grips of ever more violent and defiant gangs. Alessandro Ampietti, Al Jazeera, Quito.
Internationally, a constitutional crisis is escalating in Poland after the arrest of two former government ministers convicted of abuse of power. The pair are being supported by Poland's President Andrzej Duda, and it's in direct defiance of the country's recently elected Prime Minister Donald Tusk. Al Jazeera's Paul Brennan reports.
The arrests of former Interior Minister Mariusz Kamiński and his one-time deputy Maciej Wasik have turned a simmering political rivalry into a constitutional crisis. Kamiński and Wasik had taken refuge for several hours in the palace of their political ally, President Andrzej Duda. It was an extraordinary act of defiance directed at Poland's recently elected Prime Minister Donald Tusk, who responded by accusing the president of obstructing justice.
To be direct, it is obvious sabotage. I'm very, very concerned about this. And it's not about Wasik or Mr. Kamiński. That's the court's decision. But I'm worried that President Duda is involved.
The specific dispute is over whether President Duda was legally entitled to grant pardons to Kamiński and Wasik after they were convicted of abuse of power in 2015. The Supreme Court said he wasn't entitled. He disagrees and accuses Tusk of brutality.
I must tell you that as President of the Republic of Poland and as a man who believes in a just and honest Poland, I am deeply shaken by this situation, by the fact that they were put in prison despite a presidential pardon and with such zeal and such brutality.
At its core, this is a bitter power struggle involving the new centre-left government led by Tusk and the presidency led by Duda, who remains closely aligned with the previous government of the right-wing nationalist Law and Justice Party. Duda is making it clear he will oppose Tusk's agenda, and Duda's presidential term runs until mid-2025. It's going to be a very tough 18 months. Paul Brennan, Al Jazeera.
And finally, the International Court of Justice has finished hearing arguments on day one of the case that Israel is committing genocide in its war in Gaza. South Africa filed a lawsuit in December in a move welcomed by several countries amid a global chorus for a ceasefire in Gaza. South Africa wants the UN's top court to issue so-called provisional measures to order Israel to end its war. Al Jazeera's Michael Appiah reports.
South Africa tells the International Court of Justice,
please be seated.
The world is witnessing a textbook case of genocide unfold in Gaza.
This killing is nothing short of destruction of Palestinian life. It is inflicted deliberately. No one is spared, not even newborn babies.
It has started legal proceedings against Israel in the UN's highest legal body, looking to show a pattern of large-scale homicidal destruction that qualifies as acts of genocide.
For the past 96 days, Israel has subjected Gaza to what has been described as one of the heaviest conventional bombing campaigns in the history of modern warfare.
South Africa is arguing Israel's military campaign since Hamas's attack on southern Israel on October the 7th has been nothing short of the systematic destruction, in whole or in part, of Palestinians as a population group.
As we stand today, 1% of the Palestinian population in Gaza has been systematically decimated.
In order to establish intent, South Africa's lawyers say the court has the benefit of simply being able to listen to the words of the Israeli leadership.
Israel's political leaders, military commanders, and persons holding official positions have systematically and in explicit terms declared their genocidal intent.
Their messages filtering down into the rank and file of the Israeli army, singing proudly.
Madam President.
Genocidal language, says Thembeka Nqukayethobi, comes from the very top.
Genocidal utterances are therefore not out in the fringes. They are embodied in state policy.
Palestinians have suffered 75 years of oppression, 57 years of occupation, and 16 years of a siege on Gaza. And for all that time,
Israel, for years, has regarded itself as beyond and above the law. As the UN Special Rapporteur on the Occupied Palestinian Territories explained in 2022, and I quote, "The occupation by Israel has been conducted in profound defiance of international law and hundreds of United Nations resolutions with scant pushback from the international community."
Outside the court, in the streets of Ramallah and the occupied West Bank, and among those crammed into an ever smaller sliver of land in Gaza, South Africa has given hope to a people crying out for their suffering to be seen and literally dying to be heard. Michael Apple, Al Jazeera.
This brings us to the end of our regional and global news coverage. Up next is the 3-day weather forecast. And that's Safe TV 2 headline news for this Thursday evening. As we take our leave, we invite you to follow us on Facebook and YouTube. You can tune in tomorrow at 6:30 a.m. for a rebroadcast and at 5:30 p.m. for more news. Until then, please take care of yourself and each other.